It's not just happening in Africa or India or Mexico or China. God is looking for Christians all over America and Canada that would go into hospitals and raise the dead and heal the sick. And we're going to see cancer wards. I just prophesy this over Canada. The dead will be raised in this church, and the dead will be raised and transformed. Come on, I want to see car accidents and get out and pull people that are dead out of the car. I want to walk into hospitals and unplug life support. The dead have to be raised. We are not in this to play church. Listen, the excitement of the church comes when God does something. I'll tell you why the church is filled with boring, lukewarm, bored Christians. Because God's not moving. The reason why young people and old people and Christian people get excited, can I get water, and get passionate is because God begins to move. Listen, if God does not move in your life, you will not be excited. And here's how the church has always been. I preached last night about Gilead and the half of the tribes that wanted to cross and the tribes that didn't want to cross. And Israel became a divided nation. It was divided by people that wanted to cross over and people that didn't want to cross over. And now 1,000 years later, there's a divided church, and half the church wants fire. Half the church wants miracles. Half the church wants the dead get raised. And the other half want to know when service is going to be out. Listen, friend, if you're in here tonight waiting until we're going to dismiss you, you're dismissed now. We are not in seventh grade math class where we watch the clock to see when we can leave. We are here despite time, despite our own efforts, because we've, why? Because we're all Christians and we've died to ourselves. And it is no longer a selfish, worldly Isaiah that lives, but Christ in me. So I want you to just take off your watch. I'm going to have someone take that clock down. Because I'm going to tell you, the two things the Christians in America and in Canada hate is long services and loud services. And the two themes of heaven are long services and loud services. And if you don't like loud services and you don't like long services, you might as well go to hell. Listen, we are going to be in heaven for all of eternity worshiping. And guess what? You're not going to get the latest Jesus culture song. You're not going to get the latest Rick Pino song, and I love all these guys, I'm friends with them, but there's not going to be a new CD coming out. They sing the same verse, the same song, and the same thing, and it goes something like this. Not grace, 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 the Lord God Almighty. They sing holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, the one who was and is. You live in three dimensions because he came, he's here, and he's coming. The one who was and is to come. And then when they're done, guess what they sing again? Oh yeah, you guessed it right. Holy, holy, holy. And every time, and nobody in the service is bored. And you know what breaks my heart? I go to churches all over America, and thank God we're not in one. Amen. Your pastor's a rock star, so we're not in a boring church. Where Christians are bored. And pastors say, how do you get people excited? You get the Holy Spirit to start doing stuff. Me and Pastor Mike would sit down and say one day, back last year, say one day God's going to bring in young people. Oh, there wasn't young people at the time. And one day God's going to bring in drug addicts. And one day God's going to bring in party animals. And one day God's going to bring in young people that used to riot for the world but are going to riot for the kingdom. And one day God's going to bring in prostitutes and orphans and widows. And one day, Pastor Mike, I know it's not happening at your church yet, but God's going to heal the sick and God's going to raise the dead. And God's going to move. And we might not be excited yet, but there's going to come a day where we're passionate, where we're excited. And I'm here tonight, and that day is upon us, because young people are getting saved and old people are getting saved and Christians are getting saved. Oh, we're going to get some Christians saved here tonight. We're going to get some Pharisees saved here tonight. We're going to get some Sadducees saved here tonight. We are not going to sit back and preach messages that allow God to spew you out. And after he spews you out, he'll spew the preacher out. Because the preacher is the one responsible. Listen, it's happening. Why does this not excite us? Why are we more concerned with hockey and sports and stupid things that do not matter in 100 years when God is moving upon us? Let me tell you why we're excited, because the prodigal son came home. You know, the religious spirit hates loud stuff. Why? Because it hurts their ears? No, because it hurts their spirit, because they remember when they used to be excited about God. Remember when the prodigal son, I'm not preaching on tonight because I have a message called the older brother, but I'm not going there because it'll offend you more than my message I have tonight. Remember when the younger brother comes home? What does the older brother say? What's all the noise about? Remember that? Why are they having a party in my father's house? And the servant goes, because your brother came home, because God is saving the lost. The party in heaven happens when God saves the lost, not when you fill your notebook up with the latest revelation and get a good program for your kids. You want to know what makes heaven loud and what makes heaven celebrate? Is when young people that didn't want God start wanting God. When old people that didn't want God start wanting God. What makes God excited is testimonies. And listen, the reason why we get bored in Christianity, because God's not moving. So what do? We have to mask it with light machines and smoke machines and fire. I've been to conferences they've invited me to preach at, and the pastor goes, oh yeah, we spent $50,000 on the sound system and $80,000 for 3 days, $50,000. And pastor will tell you, because we know about sound. I'm a sound guy. That's why I like that these Mackie speakers are turned up, because I know they could be loud. And they spend 50 grand on a 3-day event, and we give $500 a year to missions. Why? Because we're not there to worship God, we're there to worship man. And when the smoke fades and the lights are done, and the cute little worship leader that has nice cute little clothes on and his skinny jeans and his outfit took him longer than his prayer, I'm telling you, when that's all game over, the young people go back to their vomit, because they didn't encounter God, they encountered a man. And man can't change you. Only God can change you. We are not going to let this next revival be based on one person and one personality. It's going to be based on all generations, all colors, all gifts. That's why you go, I don't like rap. Too bad. Did God ask for your permission before he sent his son and build a church that was passionate, loud, and vibrant? No, God did not come to build a boring church. Jesus did not get whipped and beaten on a cross so we could be bored and sit there. Oh, well, that's not that really big. Oh, is he talking to me? Oh, he's just, how old is he? And did he go to the Bible college? And when did he graduate? And when did he get saved? And how long has he been there? And what denomination are you? As if any of that is even in the Bible. No, Acts 4:13 says unskilled, uneducated, pretty much they're idiots. You know, the disciples were in, you know, but they had marveled that these dudes met Jesus. And listen, you might not like the message, friend, and you might not like the jumping and the rap, but you can't deny that we've been with Jesus. And if you were to hear every young person's testimony in this place, it would rock your religious world to see people that used to cut holes in their arm and burn their own skin and get tortured. I had a young girl come to my meeting back at the house and say, I'm 9 years old, I have a 5-year-old brother, and my parents beat me every night. Would you pray for me? Now, I could pray some carnal, lukewarm prayer like, Jesus loves you, go home and have a good night. But when she gets home, dad gets a belt because he's drunk and beats her. But I said, I believe that if we pray right now, angels will show up at your house. And when you get home, the love of the Father will come over your abusive father. And she came back months later and said, 9 years old, I'll never forget at her house. And said, ever since that night, I came home. And my dad usually comes in my room and whips me and my brother, 5-year-old brother, whips us with a belt. But since that moment, he looks in our room and keeps on walking, because angels showed up. We got to believe God for the impossible. We got to believe God for the radical. Stop believing for things that are possible. We waste so much of our prayers on things that we can do. God, grow my church. Jay-Z could grow a church. In fact, Rihanna, Jay-Z, and Lil Wayne have bigger churches than us. And our youth groups are so busy trying to look like MTV, and we're not even doing a good job at that. Because our style is about 2 years behind, and we have about half the budget they have. So stop trying to be like the culture and start trying to be like the king. The world is not going to change by our compromise sprinkled with Jesus on top. It's going to change when cancer falls out of people. I'm going to get into the message in 2 minutes, okay? Is that okay? I told you to take off your watch, or you should be okay. We had a girl come to the house meeting. I wanted to share like two testimonies just because, and I love the one Nino shared. That got me. I almost got saved when he shared that. I was like, I'm going to get saved right now. I don't even care. I don't even know the God. I'm just going to get saved because God is real. And if God is real, that means that. And we had a girl come to the house, and she came to Nino. We're in a house, our revival. And I think a lot of you don't think it's still going. It is still going because we haven't talked about it much, but there's still a revival raging in Manteca. That's every Tuesday night. It's ridiculous. New people come every week. We're seeing radical miracles, the lost being found, religious people getting found, and sickness falling off of people, and dead people getting raised. Like, Nino, this is like every week occurrence. People getting bones that weren't there before and kidneys that weren't there before. Nino's wife was born without an eardrum. She's a head nurse of Kaiser. She's educated. She's not these, you know, revival yo-yos that go, oh, I got healed, and the next week they die of cancer. We're not talking about that. We have integrity, and we get things tested. We laid hands on my aunt who was born with no eardrum, okay? And she got a brand new eardrum. And she went to work on Monday, and all of her friends are doctors, and they said, oh, Valerie, what'd you do this weekend? You know, I bought a brand new BMW, and I went out because they're all rich, and I went on this, and Nina goes, oh, I got a brand new eardrum. Listen, and you can be atheist all you want. You can be Muslim all you want. Yeah, I still have yet to hear a testimony of Allah creating an eardrum. But if you have a good one, come and tell me. I still have yet to hear a testimony of Buddha doing anything. Buddha's dead, and he ain't getting back up. So stop serving a dead idol and a dead God. There is only one true living God. And the Bible says nobody comes unto the Father but through Jesus. The lady comes up and tells Nino, I have a 14-year-old daughter. She has cervical cancer, and the doctors don't know how long she's going to live. Okay, we don't do cute little Jesus, bless your finances, prayers, tap you on the head, then go to the green room after. And I know that's popular in the church and where we travel. They go, oh, brother, I remember I was at a large church. I won't say the name because every one of you know it. Multiple thousand people, millions streamed over the web and God TV, everything. And I got done preaching. Me and Nino were there for the first time. And they, oh, man, this bugged me. And thousands of people come forward, probably about 800 realistically to 900 people respond to the altar call. And I'm like, all right, roll up my sleeves. This is where it gets good, right? This is why we're here. We're not here to preach a cute message, get an honorarium, and then fly to the next event. We're here to talk to people, be real, pray for people, love on people, change people. The Son of God did not come to be served, but to serve. And we got up, and the pastor said, oh, come to the back. And they made us a cute little push the people away so we can get the superstar evangelist upstairs to eat and talk to all the other superstar evangelists that all they want. And everyone's exchanging business cards, and everyone's saying how big their church is. Oh, come on, pastors all know about this. Oh, how big is your church? Oh, how big is your church? Oh, how big? It doesn't matter if your church has 5,000, they're all dead. How many did you get saved at the event? How many stay saved after the event? Oh yeah, brother, we got 800 saved because 800 people prayed a prayer and filled out a card. Oh yeah, 800 salvations at our last drama and our dance. No one preached the gospel. No one talked about the cross. No one talked about holiness. The blood wasn't mentioned. Repentance wasn't mentioned. Turning away from the world wasn't mentioned. The narrow road wasn't mentioned, but 800 got saved. How did they get saved? They didn't get saved according to the gospel of the Bible. They got saved according to the gospel of the church. And then we number go, oh, 800 people got saved. We must be doing a good job. And God is nowhere to be found. And Nino prays for her, and Nino literally says this, I'm literally going to rebuke the cancer, and I'm just going to command it to come out of her body. Because it's way cooler for cancer to come out of your body than just disappear. Come on now. That's way cooler of a story. The cancer came out, then it disappeared. I mean, disappearing is cool, but I'd rather it fall out and have evidence, amen? The girl goes home the next day, and this is one of my favorite testimonies. We have about 1,000 of these, and I'm grateful. The testimonies don't belong to us. They belong to God. I remember Bill Johnson one time said, you know, I wasn't going to tell any testimonies, and God said, tell them. They're not yours, they're mine, so you better tell them because they're not your testimonies. You don't have a choice. So we pray. The next day, the girl's screaming in the bathroom, 14. I won't be graphic because there's kids around. And they're Mexican, so let me just say that ahead of time. Mexicans are, they'll just do, they're all right, I'm not going to go there. I'm half Mexican, so I know how it is. She's screaming, ah, there's something coming out of me. Okay, 14 years old, stage 4 cervical cancer, tumors all over her cervix. And the mom does what every Mexican would do, goes and gets a Ziploc bag. Because if you know anything about Mexicans, we don't use Tupperware, we use Ziploc bags. And if you invite us to your barbecue, we're going home with a couple bags of carne. Okay, just letting you know. She gets a Ziploc bag. And she does something, I would have flushed that junk down, said, devil, get behind me. I don't know what kind of infection. You know, and I'm assuming the mom's thinking, this is a result of the cancer. This is, you know, fluids, whatever. The mom puts her hand in the toilet and begins to grab balls of squishy flesh. She literally said, Isaiah, it was like balls of skin. It's like big balls of skin were in the toilet. And she picks them all up, sticks them in. Oh, that's nasty, man. I feel like I'm not eating after this. Puts them in the Ziploc bag, goes to the hospital, okay? And we tell people at our revival, do not tell us testimony unless you have proof. The doctors have proved it. Somebody's proved it. Don't just say, oh, I got healed, and we're not doing all that. We don't do fake, we don't testify or prophesy. We saw that in every other revival, and we're not going to do that to rile people up. Why would we make things up when God's moving? Takes it to the hospital, and the doctors get it and go, we're freaking out. We don't know what this is. We think we know what it is, but we're going to run some tests on it. So they tested the testimony. That's good. They tested it. She goes back to the doctor several days later. This is all before our next revival meeting. And she's at the revival telling me the story. And she says, the doctor came in freaked out, scratching his PhD, rubbing his bachelor, going, I don't know what in the world just happened. I don't know. And he said this, whatever, doctor, medical miracle, whatever, that's demonic. He said, I don't know what to tell you, but this is cervical cancer. We did a scan on your daughter, and she is 100% cancer free. I don't know how it happened. Oh, come on. I know how it happened. Jesus is not dead. He didn't stay in the tomb. The Bible says on the third day, the Son of God got back up and gave us keys to his kingdom so we can lay hands on the sick and watch them recover, so we can speak to dead people and dead people will get up. And then she said, it gets gooder. I don't usually say that because I have a little better grammar. No, I'm just kidding. She said this. She said, I have 8 brain tumors. And some of you are still sitting there like God owes you something. This can't be real. Whatever. It doesn't matter what you believe. It's still real. Yeah. I love all these reformed people. You know, the strange fire. It's only strange because you don't have it. You understand? The only time the fire is strange is when you don't have the fire. Well, the gifts passed away. The gifts didn't pass away. The Bible says the gifts will pass and knowledge will pass when Jesus comes, not when the Bible comes. The Bible is not that which is perfect. Jesus is that. So there goes your reformed theology crushed down the drain. Thank you, Bible. Now, the mom comes and says, I have 8 brain tumors. Okay, daughter gets healed of cancer. Mom has 8 brain tumors now. And I'm thinking there's a generational curse happening in the family. And I'm not prophetic, but I'm pretty sure that's the story. Pray for the mom. I told the mom, I almost wanted to laugh. I didn't want to laugh, but I knew God was going to heal her. I'm like, God, you have your daughter's cancer in a Ziploc bag. I mean, come on, I don't have to preach to you to know God's about to do something. Pray for the mom. A week later, I'm about to preach, or I'm at a Christian bookstore. I'm preaching that night. She sends me a text, and just all exclamations, all capital letters, freaking out. You're not going to believe this. She said it like 9 times. I'm like, well, I'm not going to if you keep saying that. I'm not going to believe this. You're not going to call me, text me. I'm in the hospital right now. They've already done 3 scans. You're not going to believe what happened. And I'm like, all this doubt hit me. I leave the Christian bookstore because there's nothing really in there of God anyways. And I get outside the Christian bookstore, and I'm like, well, the 12-step books I just got done looking at aren't going to work for this. And I'm like, what happened? Tell me what happened. And she's like, the doctors did 1 scan and they said, this can't be right. They did a 2nd scan. They said, there's no way this is right. We have the proof here. You have 8 brain tumors. They said, we did another scan and the tumors are 100% gone. 8 brain tumors. And in 1 prayer, come on, it only takes 1 prayer for God to do the impossible. It don't take 4 years of Bible college. It takes the Holy Ghost showing up. What? Now let me get practical. What does this do for a revival? It keeps the people excited. The second the people stop being excited is the second us as leaders know the oil's burned out and the fire's gone. And then we have to fabricate it. We have to dance. And our messages come from Sermon Central rather than a prayer closet. Because we lose the connection. Why? Because it's easier to do ministry than to be ministry. See, here's what you have to understand. Peter was in ministry, but ministry wasn't in Peter until Peter finally met Christ. And when Peter really met Christ, he went from being in ministry and not in Christ to being in Christ and in ministry. Hear me, friend. You can be in ministry and not in Christ, but you can't be in Christ and not in ministry. Let me say it one more time so you can tweet it. You can be in Christ. I mean, you can be in ministry and not in Christ, but you can't be in Christ and not be in ministry. See, our job is not to teach you how to minister. Our job is to teach you how to live in Christ. Because it's the personality of Christ. Because Christ was not moved by honorariums. Christ was moved by compassion. And too many preachers are moved by emotions, honorariums, and crowds, and they end up burning out, living 6 months on a couch, suicidal, because they weren't doing it for God, they were doing it for man. That's why Jesus said, did we not prophesy? Did we not do miracles? Did we? And Jesus says, depart, you worker of lawlessness. And he goes, I don't know you. The word new there, he goes, I never knew you. The word new is literally, it has to do with intimacy. When the Bible says Mary never knew Joseph, it means they never had sexual relationships together before Jesus was born. And they take the same Greek word and they stick it in that verse. And Jesus says, you did all these awesome things, but there was no personal intimacy with me. In other words, you don't know me. You do miracles in my name. You prophesy. And let me just scare you one last time before I get into the message. I'm going to go as quick as possible. I'm going to skip like 9 points because I'm 15 minutes in and I'm going to start right now. Hear me. He wasn't talking to Baptist people. I want you to get this. Because Baptist people don't lay hands on the sick. They don't prophesy. And they don't cast out demons. He was talking to two groups in the church, Pentecostals and Charismatics. So he gets the church and he narrows it all the way down. This is scary here. And he picks only the people that are doing signs and wonders, who the Bible says, if you believe, they will follow. We don't follow signs and wonders. Signs and wonders follow us. Because if you're following him, they're going to follow you. What if they're not following me? Let's just basic logic. You're not following him. Listen. This is simple. I don't have to yell and be mean about it. If signs and wonders and miracles aren't happening in your life, then you have to look back and say, I might be following the God of the American church, but am I following the God of the scripture? Because we can't find one disciple that didn't lay hands on the sick. We can't find one. Scholars cannot find a disciple that didn't cast out demons. Why? Was demon casting out for certain ministries? Pastor, well, bro, that's good. You cast demons. That's for your ministry. And I'm like, you don't know any demons? Pastor, friend, let me ask you. Do you know anyone demon possessed? Every single one of you, some of you might be. Every single one of you knows somebody that has demons. So is it Isaiah's job to start a big ministry and cast out all the demons of America? No, it's every one of our job. We've turned the basic things of the faith for superstars. And there's no superstars in the Bible. In fact, Paul said, I'm less than any apostle. And can I be honest? When I stand up on the stage, I feel so unworthy every time I preach. I am the weakest vessel God could possibly pick, and I was going to be a deputy sheriff. Let me just arrest some bad guys and drink my drink and buy my house. And God, like he always does, has to get up in the middle of our plan when we're trying to do our, I'm just trying to get through hair school, and I'm just trying to get through college, and I'm just trying to work the oil fields. God, would you leave me alone? I murdered a guy. I'm hiding in the backside of the desert, and the burning bush shows up and says, I'm going to keep bugging you until you give it all. God will not stop harassing you. Jehovah harassment is in the house, and he will keep poking at your flesh until you deal with. Well, why does a preacher always talk about compromise? Maybe because you're in compromise. And my job here tonight is not to make friends, it's to preach the truth. I'm going to go quick, and I'm going to skip through, and we're going to end. 1 Samuel chapter 15. You don't have to turn there. I'm sorry, chapter 8. You don't have to turn there because I'm not going to put anything on the board. I just want to go for it for the sake of time. I want to honor this house. I want to honor the time. I want to honor what God's doing. And I don't want anyone to leave. And if you leave, I will call you out and give you a bad prophetic word. I feel like I could joke in here. I feel like, okay, we're not religious. We can laugh. It was a joke. I'm not going to give a bad prophetic word to you. I'm not like most preachers. I just see finances over you. I'm like, I've heard that a billion times. Or when people see you ministering and then they prophesy over you after what you just did. Yeah, Isaiah, I don't know you, Isaiah, after I preach. Like, I don't know. These are the prophets we have in America. I don't really know you, but I see a mic in your hand and I just see ministry all over you. I'm like, I'm the keynote speaker. Come on, we got to stop prophesying. It's making us look like a joke. If you don't have a word from God, shut your mouth until God gives you a word. Get in the secret place and get a hold of God. Now, the children of Israel came to a place where they thought it would be better to look like the world than to look like God. Now, the Bible says that the elders of Israel got before Samuel. Samuel was the senior prophet of Israel. There was no dude as bad as Samuel. Samuel was the bomb. No, Bible says no matter what Samuel spoke, it happened. That's pretty bad. So whatever Samuel said, God would make it happen. He honored this dude that much. Samuel's running and leading the nation of Israel as God's spokesman. We're not just preachers, we're spokesmen. You know, the Bible says the Holy Spirit came to the world to convict the world of sin. And I tell preachers, if you're not convicting people in your ministry, the Holy Spirit's not worth you. And I had pastors say, well, brother, it's not my job to convict people, it's the Holy Spirit. Does the Holy Spirit speak through you? Listen, I would love if the Holy Spirit, some say he's blue, I don't know what color he is, I really don't care. I would love if he floated in here and he grabbed the mic because a lot more people would come. And I would love for the Holy Spirit to get up and preach tonight. But the reality is the Holy Spirit uses people, why? To see if you will submit under a person before you submit under God. If you can't submit to someone you can see, you won't submit to someone you can't see. So the Holy Spirit speak. You go, God, speak to me. And then I preach. And you're like, God, speak to me. And I preach. And you're like, God, and God's like, I am speaking to you, bozo. You just don't listen. So the people came, and the Bible says that all the elders and all the people and the leaders of Israel came before Samuel, because usually when you want to tell your pastor he's not doing a good job, you find a whole little group before you do it. I love those churches inside the churches that think that they're really churches and they're not churches. They're rebellions, and then they split the church, and then the wheat and the tare. And the Bible says the angels will separate the wheat from the tare, and Jesus will cut off the... I'm not going into that because you really won't like me if I preach the Bible. And the Bible says that the people came to Samuel and said, we want a king. We don't want a prophet to rule us anymore. We want popularity, personality, and approval to lead us. We don't want presence, power, and fire. See, and you have to understand, it was the majority of the church. And then Samuel's going, why? And they go, because we want to be like the world. We don't want God in our churches, because if God shows up in our churches, we can't look like the world. And if we don't look like the world, we don't believe people will come. And the majority of the church, like the majority of the leaders of Israel, are corrupt. And they rather be like the world than be like God. And the Bible says the majority of the leaders got before Samuel and said, give us a king, because we want to be like the world. And when are you going to get sick and tired of letting our churches look like the world? When are we going to get sick and tired of dressing like the people from MTV? When did this cool thing come into the church? It's not kingdom. We are supposed to look like men from another planet. Jesus said, I'm sending you as lambs among wolves. Does anybody in this room be not able to tell the difference between a lamb and a wolf? What was Jesus saying? He was saying, you're going to look so different. It would be like if I put a lamb or a sheep next to a wolf. Can you tell the difference, friend? Yes. Yet we go into the world and nobody knows the difference between us. Oh, what church do you go to? Oh, come to my church. We look no different. We talk no different. We dress no different. And we act no different. And then we sit back, bash ourselves over the head, and go, why is God not moving? God can't move upon worldliness and carnality. It's against his nature. And God is not going to change the Bible for a bunch of lukewarm Christians. God will only move when he finds a people that are holy. God will only move when he finds a people that are sanctified. God will only move when he finds a people that are set apart. God is not looking for more Christian rock stars. God is looking for the sons and daughters to be revealed and to go into the earth and shake the planet. They say, we want to be, and then Samuel goes, okay, and Samuel's angry because they're rejecting, and God goes, Samuel, hear me, friend, they're not rejecting you, they're rejecting me. Because when you're in covenant with God, you share his enemies. And then God says, you know, before they make this decision, before they press this and go, we're going to do this, we want a king, because God goes, I'll give them what they want. Hear me, if you want porn, God will let you go watch porn all you want. And you know, I find God will allow you to turn you over to sin just so you realize how miserable you are without him. See, I have never met in my entire life one person that genuinely got encountered and met God. I know a lot of people that backslide and go back, and I don't think it's a biblical term, but that was a whole other message. And I've never met one of them that were more happy with a bottle than the cross. I have, listened, I talk to young people all over America. I talk to thousands all on social network. And every single one of them say, I went to church. I got the fire. I feel the Holy Ghost on this. I got the fire. I consecrated. I sanctified. I gave it up. God changed me. And then I went back to the world and I'm miserable. There's not one, listen, friend, that goes back to drugs, sex, or alcohol that's more happy than when they gave up everything for the cross. It's not legalism, it's holiness. Let me give you the difference, because I've been really listening to all of your conversations all the last 3 days. What are the young people talking about? What are they arguing over? And all I've heard is legalism, and it's legal, and there's not that what I'm saying is legalism, but the argument of legalism and grace. Let me give it to you quick. Legalism is what you do for men to see. Holiness is what you do for God to see. Listen, when I got saved, I had 45,000 songs in my iTunes. I was in a metal band. We were doing stuff. I went home. No preacher told me. Hear me. I broke every one of my Xbox games. Listen. I smashed my Xbox. I threw all my alcohol. I threw all everything that was not of God. I deleted 45,000 worldly songs. I broke up with a girl. I was about to marry for 4 years. I deleted all my contacts. I deleted my Facebook. Why did a preacher say, we need to give up TV and we need to give up video games and you're all going to hell? No, I met a man that was 10 times better than the movies. I met a man that was 10 times better than the music. I met him. Listen, the difference is you fall in love and the issue is not God's love. I got to get this across because everywhere I go, everyone's like, what do you think about the love of God? It's awesome. It's not a negative. Grace is not a cuss word. It's not a negative term. Perverted grace is what we should be calling it. Because real grace doesn't allow you to go back. Paul said, if you've experienced grace, you can't sin anymore because you've died to that, what you're living in now. And how could you die to something that you're living in? Listen, friend, the difference is this. The issue isn't God's love. John 3:16, thank you, Tim Tebow. We all know the verse now. For God so loved the world, he gave his only son, who shall not perish by eternal life. The son of God not come to the world, but through him the world might be saved. Because there's a choice you have to make. Then he says, but here's the issue. Men love darkness more than light. You'll never hear that because that's not popular. It's the same exact chapter. The issue isn't God's love for you because let me just say this. I'll never say it again. God loves a prostitute. God loves a homosexual. God loves the witch. God loves the drug addict. God loves the drug user. God loves God loves the Wiccan. God loves the Buddhist. God loves the Muslim. But do they change because God loves them? Listen, the reason why I'm faithful to my wife isn't because she loves me. It's because I love her. Jesus, now the disciples were all talking about God's love. Oh my gosh, God's love is so awesome. We just love this hippie Jesus we've created in the church. And they're all talking about Jesus. And Jesus turns around and goes, stop. Because if we keep with this doctrine, it's going to get real unhealthy in the church. And Jesus looks at him and says, friend, it's not about how much I love you. Because we already talked about in John 3:16, I love everybody. We've already covered that doctrine. He says, the problem is you don't love me. He said, if you loved me, what would you do? Keep my commandments. Whoa! There's no rules, brother. We're in grace now. Come on, you haven't heard you've seen the large conference. We're not on that side of the cross. We don't live by the law. So just smoke the joint and drink the drink because everyone's under grace and God doesn't care anymore. Jesus didn't abolish the law. He became the law. And it says there's no condemnation for them that walk in the spirit, not in the flesh. So if you walk in the flesh, there's condemnation. Paul said this. Paul said, I hate the law because I can't obey the law, but I love the law because the Spirit gives me power over the law. The Spirit brings life, but the law brings death. What was Paul saying? Because he sounds bipolar. Paul was saying this. The law, listen, I need to get this to you tonight. The law is the rules and regulations, and it shows me what I shouldn't be doing. But in my own strength, I can't not do that. He says, but then I get the Spirit. The law is bringing me death. The Spirit, now I look at the law and it's easy. See, because on January 12, 2011, I went from watching porn every 4 hours, from saying the F word every other word in my mouth, from drinking 15 hours a day, from taking advantage of girls and doing this and leading people and destroying property and destroying cars, to in 1 second completely sober, never drank again, never cussed again, never smoked again, never did anything again. Why? Because the Spirit let me live out the law. And the law wasn't some rules and regulations. It was the Spirit. That is why Paul said, do what the Pharisees are doing, just don't do it while they're doing it. The Pharisees, the issue wasn't what they were doing was wrong, because it's not wrong to worship God and to go to the temple. The issue was they were doing it out of legalism, not out of holiness. And the Bible says they wanted men to see, but they went behind closed doors and they had secret sin. See, legalism is having secret sin and then jumping through the hoops at church. Holiness is jumping through the hoops at church and then going home and having a life of holiness. And listen, true character is not tested by what you do at church. True character is by what you do at 2 a.m. The real you is not the hallelujah, jump and shout, Shonda Rondo Kondo, roll over, shake, rattle, and roll. The real you is you at 1:30 a.m. when nobody's watching, when pastor's not down your throat, when Isaiah Saldivar's not in town. Will you go back to your vomit or not? The people said, we want to be like the world. And Samuel tells, if you're going to be like the world, this is what's going to happen. Since you want to sin, I'm going to tell you the consequences of sin. If you want to look like the world, I'm going to tell you. And God says, Samuel, let them have a king. Turn him over. Judas, you can have the 30 pieces of silver, but you can't have me and the 30 pieces of silver. And Samuel goes, all right, Saul, all right, people, I want to let you know, if you choose the king, because you can choose sin if you want when you leave this place. He says, they're going to ravage your homes. They're going to take your women. They're going to use your daughters. They're going to everything, because the devil, trust me, he will have what he has coming to him. Sin is not free. There is a day where you will get rung up, and all the things you did, God will say you did that and that, because sin is not free. He says, and the consequences of them choosing that did not stop them from choosing that. See, because I could tell you, if you watch porn, you'll never be called, but you're still going to watch porn, because it's not consequences that stop us from sin. It's love. Not God's love for us, our love for God. What stops me from going and watching porn at night is because I'm so obsessed with God. I have such a righteous fear of his judgment and his hand. I don't even want to go near the devil or near sin, because I fell in love with somebody that would hurt him if I went there. So he said, but the people still chose it. Do you want to know how to burn hotter for God than lust? You want to know how to defeat lust? Burn hotter for God. You want to know how to defeat drugs? Burn harder for God. You want to know how to defeat adultery? Burn harder for God. The more you fall in love with God, the less you fall in love with the world. And if you truly love God, you won't sin. 1 John. So the people get a king. It's King Saul. The difference between, I'm going to end in a second, Saul and David was that Saul only repented when he got caught, and David repented when the presence came. David, both Saul and David were bad leaders, not bad leaders, but both of them had their issues, like all of us. They all had their downfalls, and the difference was David didn't wait till the pastor pointed him out to repent. David repented because he was so afraid of God, and he so missed his presence. Now in 1 Samuel 15, the Bible says that Samuel anoints King Saul to defeat the Amalekites, because the anointing has a purpose. God does not anoint you for no reason. God anoints you for purpose, on purpose, with purpose. When God is going to anoint, I want to talk about losing the anointing tonight. When God is going to anoint somebody, he will only anoint somebody that's going to do something with the anointing. I see young people come to altars and say, I want the fire. I want the healing anointing. And I'm like, you haven't done nothing with the anointing God's given you. You haven't done nothing with the fires God's given you. Why do you want more when you haven't done anything with what you have? The guy with the one talent wasn't going to get more talents till he did something with the one talent. And the guy with the five talents doubled his talent than the guy with the one talent. Because God will not anoint someone unless there's a purpose. And specifically, Samuel comes and says, I'm going to anoint you to be king, but I'm going to anoint you for a specific reason. Not so you can be famous on God TV. Not so you can have 5,000 followers on Twitter, because I have a lot of thousands of followers, and you can still be empty with thousands of followers. Not so everyone will like you, and not so you can preach good. Jesus said, I have been anointed to proclaim the gospel to the poor. Preachers hate preaching to poor because they don't give big offerings. I've come to break the chains, to heal the brokenhearted. Jesus had a reason. Why do you want the anointing? Just stop right here and think. Real quick, just stop. How much time do we throw around this word anointing? I want the anointing. The man of God has the anointing. Did you see that anointing? Did you hear the anointing on that song? Songs aren't anointed. People are anointed. This is going to mess you up. There's no such thing as an anointed song. There's a such thing as an anointed worship leader. The anointing has a purpose. And if you want the anointing, but you don't want the purposes of God, do not ask for the anointing, because you have no clue what you're asking for. And we're all in here going, I want the anointing. You want the anointing as long as it doesn't pass an hour and a half long on Sunday morning. You want the anointing as long as it fits into your worldly 9-to-5 job and your carnal schedule of sports and games. God is not looking to fit in your schedule. He's looking to fit you into his schedule. We're not sitting here going, God, would you be a part of what we're doing? We're going to be a part of what he's doing. We're not the king. He's the king. And God anointed Samuel to defeat the Amalekites. He said, go defeat the Amalekites. That is why I'm anointing you. That is why I'm calling you. Now, the Amalekites were old enemies of Israel. They go all the way back to Joshua and Moses. God told Moses, tell Joshua, I'm going to completely destroy the Amalekites. I'm going to destroy the remembrance of them, because God does not halfway deliver people. God is not looking to deliver you from crack so you could still cuss. God, when God destroys something in your life, he completely destroys it. God does not, listen, God does not, people go, oh, I got set free from porn. I still struggle with alcohol and drugs and cussing. But God set me free from porn. He didn't set you free. You set yourself free and you stop watching it and you're resisting the flesh for about 6 months. God told Joshua, I'm going to smash the enemy. And God says, and I want you to tell Saul, I've been taking note about what the Amalekites have done to my people. When the devil attacks you, God remembers. Every time the devil spoken bad about you, every dollar the devil's taken. I wish somebody was in here that actually has a real life and actually goes through it. Some of you look way too professional in here. Every time the devil comes after you, I've been attacked. You probably haven't. Because, see, the devil won't attack you if you're his friend. The devil only attacks churches that are fighting in the supernatural, not churches that are having youth conferences where they throw on beach balls. Pastor go, man, I had the best youth conference, and all they did was throw on beach balls and play music. Try to have a prayer meeting, and all of hell, you have a prayer meeting with two people, and hell's going to stand up and say, how could we stop Mary and Joe from getting together and praying? Why? Because the devil's not afraid of gatherings. The devil's afraid of supernatural, apostolic warfare in the heavenly realms that's going to shake principalities and powers and remove them from his kingdom. So God says, tell him I'm going to crush him. Because I took note, and he says, I watched as the Amalekites, this is all in 1 Samuel 15, attacked my people as they left Egypt. The time the devil will always attack you is a time of transition. The way the enemy works is he waits until you're vulnerable. The people were coming out of Egypt and into Canaan, and God said, I hate the Amalekites because they attacked my people when they were vulnerable. Listen to me, young man. Don't touch her. We wait. Oh, she's all Christian and nice. And now that she got hurt by her ex-boyfriend, and now that she's only been saved 2 months, this is my time to sneak in. And God hates people that take advantage of vulnerable people. And I'll tell you this. The only time the devil will really come after you is if you decide you want to come out of the world. The devil does not mind you dancing at altars. The devil does not mind you shouting. The devil does not mind you dancing. He just minds you changing. So he'll let you rondo, condo, shondo, jump all you want, and as long as you go back to that girl after. The devil will let you jump and dance as long as you go back to compromise. The devil doesn't care that you worship. He cares that you change. That is why the Bible says it was when they came out of Egypt, the Amalekites attacked them. So Samuel told Saul, destroy everything. Understand this. When God says destroy everything, it means destroy everything. It doesn't mean give up worldly music but continue to watch worldly movies. It means, and we have this thing called selective sacrifice. God says give it all up, and then we go, I'll give you some, and that'll be good because that's what we get taught, but I'm not going to give you everything because there's a couple things I still like. You know, God, I'll give you my music, and I'll give you, but I'm not going to give you everything. God says, Samuel said, Saul, you got to destroy everything. Kill everything. The kids, the children, the animals, the girls, the women, the men, everything. Destroy it all so it doesn't come back later and kill you. Now, Saul decides to go do what God had called him to do because it's easy at first to obey the call. We're not in this to run fast. We're in this to run long. Saul goes to the Canaanites who are living with the Amalekites, and he tells the Canaanites, these people were not wicked, they were not in sin, but they were dwelling with people that were in sin. So good. And Saul goes to the Canaanites and goes, listen, I'm about to destroy the Amalekites, and if you don't stop hanging out with them, I'm going to destroy you too. The reason why I don't hang out with gossipers, hear me, you want to know my life, I don't hang out with people that don't respect their pastor. I don't hang out with prophets that aren't undercovering. I don't hang out with preachers that don't preach the whole Bible. I got tons of guys like, oh, you're my friend. I'm not your friend, buddy. If you don't preach the whole word, we're not friends. Why? Because I'm not going to hang around people that are under a curse, so when the curse falls on them, it falls on me too. Saul was telling them, listen, there's a curse on this area and on the Amalekites, and if you don't stop hanging out with the world, then you're going to fall under what they fell under. How do I know? Because every young person I know has backslid because of their old friends. Well, I was at the party. I just drank a couple drinks trying to witness to all my friends because I wanted to get them saved. And God hung out with sinners. God did not hang out with sinners. He ate with sinners. You know what I did when I got saved? I called all my unsaved friends and said, do you want to go to lunch so we can talk? Why don't you just come to the party? Because I'm not strong enough to go into an environment with Amalekites. And when God decides to judge them, he judges me. I will not get caught up with people in the church that gossip. I will not get caught up with people in the church that talk bad about Pastor Michael and say, oh, he's legalistic and oh, this is just getting way too strict, brother. Then why don't you leave and stop spreading your poison to all the people around you? Because when the curse falls on them, it'll fall on you too. He said, listen, if you don't separate yourself from the world, you will be destroyed. But we're not sinning. We're not drinking at the party, doesn't matter. You're hanging around with people that are under a curse. But we're not dancing with her, you're hanging around people that are under a curse. But we're not gossiping about pastor. Do you know that listening to gossip is no different than gossiping? Listen, You being silent about the negativity that people around you are talking about your pastor is no different than you. And can I tell you that God hates gossip? The Bible says it's the devil that sows discord in the brethren. So Saul decides, I'm going to kill some of them, because that's what most of us do. That's why most of us backslide in 6 months. We can't last a year being saved. So he goes. Now the Bible says that he saves what he liked and gives up what he doesn't like. So Saul goes, I'm going to give up the music. I'm going to give up the movies. I'm going to give up the girlfriend. I'm going to give up the old friends. But I'm going to keep the anger, because I might need that at some point. I'm going to keep the unforgiveness, because you don't know what they did to me. Yet you can't get into heaven with unforgiveness. You don't understand. If you have unforgiveness, you cannot get into heaven, period. You go to hell if you have unforgiveness. I'm going to keep that. And I'm going to keep the envy and the jealousy. And I'm going to keep just this one thing, because surely God won't send me to hell for one thing. He told the rich young ruler, I have one thing against you. And if you don't get rid of that one thing, you're going to hell. Ananias and Sapphira, they didn't sell one thing and they ended up dying and going to hell. Listen, one thing will stop you. And Saul decided that he wanted to get rid of some stuff and keep some stuff. So he comes, he kills some, and then the true anointing shows up. Now Samuel's in his room, and God, I'm going to skip a couple points here for the sake of time. God shows up to Samuel and says, I regret anointing Saul. You don't ever want to hear God speak to you and say, I regret ever anointing you. Listen, friend. If you continue in disobedience and you don't kill what God says to kill, there will come a moment. Now, God doesn't do it immediately. Look at me. If you're in sin, God does not judge you immediately. He is so ridiculously gracious. And so I don't understand it, because I would judge you. He doesn't. God is so kind that God will first warn you in a dream. If God can't get to you, God will warn you and say, stop, you can't. And we do it over 6 months ago. And God says, don't keep doing it. Your call's at stake. And you keep doing it. Then second thing God sends a messenger. And someone comes up to you and goes, brother, and obviously this is a youth pastor. He's not it. Okay, I'm using example. Brother, God showed me you're dealing with something. And then I'm not doing anything. I'm holy. I'm fine. I'm just like everybody else. I don't have any compromise. I didn't keep Agag. I destroyed everything. And I go, brother, I'm just seeing something. And then all of a sudden you ignore it. And then God gives you one last chance. God goes, I'm going to come down and I'm going to manifest my presence. And I'm going to tell you one last time, if you don't get rid of this, your platform's over and I'm putting you on the shelf. You will never preach again. The anointing will never be there again. That anointing that used to come over you when you preach, you're going to preach now and that anointing's going to be gone. The anointing that used to come over you when you lay hands on the sick, you're going to lay hands on the sick and there will be no anointing. You're going to try to read and there will be no anointing. You're losing your anointing. And God says, Samuel, go tell Saul, because of his disobedience, because he didn't get rid of everything that I told him to get rid of, he kept that one thing. Go tell him I've rejected him and I purely regret making him king. And now Samuel's going, I don't want to do this. Do you think I like standing up here and preaching this? Do you think it's fun to tell people that I know that are on the broad road, that have been deceived their whole lives, that they're on the narrow road, that you're not on the broad road, that you're not? Do you think, you know how much love it takes for me to stand up here and tell you what I'm telling you tonight? Where's the love in that? Listen, if you love your kid, do you let them continue to do drugs and never say anything, or do you tell them stop doing that or it's going to kill you? You know what amazes me? That a doctor, if they see that you have cancer but don't diagnose you, will get fired off the state boards for being immoral, but preachers can't tell you have sin that'll kill you for eternity without being called legalistic. Oh, you'll go to a doctor and they'll say you got cancer and you'll walk out, thank you, doctor. I love you so much. You saved my life. But I get up here, and because I don't preach like Oprah and Dr. Phil, and you go, what professor? Who does he think he is? How old is he? Who's he to tell me I can't watch sports for 5 hours a day? I am telling you, if you don't kill Agag, Agag will kill you. And if you keep that compromise hidden in a cage somewhere, it'll come back to life and destroy your ministry. And David, Samuel comes, because a real anointing always knows when you're lying, and goes, Saul, did you do it? Knowing already God visited him, the prophet knows the truth, he didn't do it. And Saul goes, oh yeah, I'm cool. I don't got no sin. Oh, yeah, brother. We're going on Tuesday nights to the awakening. Friday night, I'll be there on the prayer line, brother. I know it's all good, all God, brother. Hallelujah. Come on. Amen, brother. With that secret sin still in you. With Agag still back at home. And Samuel goes, if you've given up everything and you killed all the compromise you said you killed, what do I hear? He says, it sounds like sheep are still neighing. And it sounds like the bleeding of sheep. Because your sin will always tell on you. You can hide it. Listen, you can be as good as Saul and you can hide it in the corner, but at some point it'll speak out and it'll testify against you. On that day of judgment, your sin will tell on you. And I'm afraid, and this scares me because this is something I struggle with. I'm afraid that on the day of judgment, Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter will testify against us to the fact we did have time to pray. I'm afraid we will get to heaven as Christians and our number one excuse will be we did not have time to pray. And I believe Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter will pop up and they will begin to testify against us and said, you spent 4 hours a day on me, you did have time to pray. You spent 2 hours a day on me, you did have time to read. And our Agag will speak out against us. And Samuel goes, if you destroyed everything, what is that that I hear? And then Saul does, we all do. It's not my fault. It's the people. It's because my mom was addicted to drugs. It's because my dad, it's pastor. Yeah, it's pastor. It's his fault I keep falling. It's not, he didn't deliver me at my scheduled appointment. So sure, Saul goes, surely it's the people. They wanted to keep the sheep. The sheep looked good. They looked harmless because compromise always looks harmless before it kills you. And Samuel goes, Saul, you're lying. You didn't. And Saul goes, yes, I did. Trust me. The people wanted to. The people. Do you know why God wanted to kill the Amalekites so bad? Because they were Israel's enemy, not just Israel enemies, but God's enemy. Because when someone comes against you, they don't come against you. They come against God. God wanted them dead so bad because the previous generations did not kill them. Moses was supposed to defeat the Amalekites, but because Moses didn't defeat them, Moses' kids had to fight them, and Moses' kids didn't fight them. And if you listen to me, every dad and every mom in this room, if you do not take care of your demons, you will leave them for your children to take care of. I have adultery through all my generations, my dad, my grandma, my grandpa, everywhere up the line. And when I got married, I promised myself, I said, my wife will not sit in her room late at night and cry herself to sleep while my children are in the other room because I'm out with a mistress. I am making it my commitment to destroy the Amalekites. My family will not fight adultery ever again. It stops here. My kids won't deal with drugs. My kids won't deal with alcohol. My kids won't deal with porn. I am killing Agag and I'm chopping him to pieces so that joker doesn't come back. Do you want to know why my family fell into adultery? Because the previous generation didn't take care of adultery. And this, and the deliverance God wanted to give them from the Amalekites, it was not natural, it was supernatural. When God wants to deliver a person, he does not do it naturally. He's not into 12-step, get out quick, and go through this and say, I drink and I'm an alcoholic. Who are you? And I'm an alcoholic. God is not into that. God is into supernatural deliverance. He told Moses, Moses, if you keep your arms up, Joshua will keep winning, which means this, if the older generation will intercede, the younger generation will win the battles. But when the older generation puts their hands down, the younger generation loses to their enemy. I'll tell you right here, honestly and bluntly, why the church, the young people in the church are nowhere to be found. I preach at a church, 7,000 members. Actually, let me take it a step further. I was at a church recently with 14,000 members. About 9,000 show up, but their membership, because that's really what we're all about, is membership, like it's Chuck E. Cheese. It's 14,000 members. You want to know how big their youth group was? They said, yeah, youth group used to be 1,000, then they fired this rock star worship leader and rock star youth pastor. Now it's down to 10 kids. Why? Because Moses doesn't have his hands up. Do you want to know why our young people are addicted to porn, cutting, and drugs? Because we don't pray. Listen, God was saying it's not the warfare of Joshua that defeats the enemy. It's the warfare of Moses. It's the intercession of the fathers that propels the... Do you want to know why I have this anointing? Do you want to know why I get to travel the United States? Do you want to know why I speak with Ryan Habanke a year being saved before 40 million people? Because I have fathers that are in their bedroom with their hands up. And when they lift their hands, I win battles. Listen, the secret to public warfare is secret prayer. Moses was, oh, this is good. I wish someone would tweet this. Moses was in private winning Joshua's battles that were in public. The secret to winning public battles is secret prayer. You do not win battles behind pulpits. You win battles in prayer closets. And if the older, I wish there was like one person over 40. If the older generation right now would begin to lift up their hands and say, we're going to dedicate ourselves to prayer. We're going to dedicate ourselves to holiness. We're going to worship when we don't feel like it. We're going to come to the meetings even if the young people are loud. All of a sudden, Joshua starts winning. All of a sudden, the Amalekites. But because Moses... couldn't keep a prayer life. Joshua couldn't keep the victory. And now we're still dealing with the same old demons our dads dealt with. We're still dealing with the same old enemy. And he goes, you didn't kill everything. You left one thing, and that was Agag. I'm going to end here because I have like 19 other points that I'm not going to go into because it's not necessary for tonight. Samuel tells Saul, God has rejected you. It's game over. Listen, when a minister falls and God decides they have made a mockery out of him for too long, he puts them on the shelf and says, I love you and you can still go to heaven and I'll love on you and you can go and join a prayer meeting, but you're not getting back behind my pulpit because you made a joke out of me and it's game over. I am putting you on the shelf. And I prophesied this a month ago. In the next 6 months, we are going to see some of the greatest leaders in America that are Christian leaders fall. And it's not that they're falling in 6 months, it's that they fell long ago, but God is going to begin to expose. God is not into hiding and covering sin. True love doesn't, listen, true love covers, true love conquers sin and doesn't just sweep it under the rug. Listen, and he looked at Samuel and said, he looked at Saul and said, Saul, it's game over. And Saul goes, no, God loves sacrifice. He's trying to use scripture like all of us do to justify the fact that he didn't kill everything. And he goes, did you not know that God wants your obedience more than he wants your sacrifice? Listen, a life of obedience produces a life of sacrifice. A life of sacrifice does not produce a life of obedience. And he said, listen, if you're obedient, you'll want to sacrifice. But just because you sacrifice something at the altar does not mean you're obeying God and does not mean you're in God's will. And I'm going to finish on this last point. He says, okay, hear me. I'm fell into sin. I didn't conquer everything God wanted me to conquer. I didn't think it was that big of a deal. Agag's still alive. The king, Agag is a king of the Amalekites. Kind of a big deal. If you're going to kill anybody, kill the king. Don't you understand? Saul killed everybody but the king. And he goes, you didn't kill Agag. And Saul goes, can I just ask you something? Would you walk out before Israel with me so they don't know I'm in sin? Nico, come up here. I want to show you what he did. They're talking in the back room. And he goes, just pardon me and walk with me so they still think I'm anointed. So let's walk like this. This way you don't see the fact that I'm in compromise. This way you don't see. Some of you in this room are walking with Samuel. You're not walking with Christ. And you're hiding behind it. And you still come to the altars. And you still worship. And you still dance. And you're walking with Samuel. And you think you're walking with Christ. But you're still walking with Samuel. Because you're afraid that somebody's going to find out you didn't kill Agag. And he did. And this guy, listen. He lost the anointing. The worst thing that could ever happen to you is not your house being burned down. Can I be honest with you? I would give up everything for the anointing. I would give up my car. I would give up my house. I would give up everything I have because the anointing is the only thing that keeps me preaching. The anointing is the only thing that gets me out of bed. The anointing is the only thing that heals the sick. The anointing is the only thing that can raise the dead. The anointing is the anything worth anything. God is tired of preachers preaching without the anointing. It's the anointing that transforms the spirit. It's the anointing that draws you while I preach. It's the anointing that transforms your heart. It's the anointing that comes over you and convicts you. It's the anointing that'll raise the dead. Without the anointing, we are clanging cymbals and we need to shut our mouths. And Saul said, I know I lost the anointing, but let's just pretend I didn't. How long are you going to pretend that you didn't lose the anointing when you know it's gone? Come on, be honest. You don't feel God's presence like you used to. And what is my call tonight? My call tonight is to kill Agag. My call is to get rid of that one thing. Some of you are going to hear it all through your heads, all through this auditorium. You're going to hear TV. You're going to hear games. Can I tell you something? And I'll be bluntly honest, and I'm not trying to expose anybody. I have talked to countless young people this trip, and almost every single one of them haven't killed Agag. Listen to me, friend. I am not here to condemn you. I'm not here to be your friend. I'm here to preach the truth and tell you what God gave me. And you can hate it or like it. That's not my job. My job is to give it to you. Your job is to respond. Every person I talk to, they said, Isaiah, I love the message and I'm changed. I'm part of the awakening and God, but there's this one thing I can't kill. There's this one thing that's poking at me. That's one thing. Can I tell you how the story ends? Because it's not a happy ending. God rejects Saul. Saul will spend the rest of his life jealous over guys that have the anointing because he lost his. Hear me. 2 Samuel, David becomes king. David waited long enough for God to anoint him, and God had to remove the wicked leadership before he can pour out onto the pure leadership. Wow. 2 Samuel, here's my ending. I promise I'm done. This is not an evangelistic lie now. This is truth. Saul's fighting on top of a hill, and Saul sees the enemy coming, so he falls on his own sword. He literally commits suicide, but he didn't die all the way. And all of a sudden, the enemy comes up, and Saul's dying, and Saul goes, would you please finish me off? And the guy comes and finishes him off. Hear me. Now we're in 2 Samuel chapter 1, and David's at home, and a guy comes running up to him. And David goes, who are you? What are you doing? And he goes, I escaped from the Israelite army. This is David's enemy now coming to him, telling him the story. He goes, I was on Mount Gilboa. He goes, and I saw Saul, and Saul had fallen on his sword. And David goes, Saul's dead. He goes, Saul's dead, and Jonathan's dead. They died on Mount Gilboa. And he goes, tell me what happened. And the guy goes, I walked up, and Saul was on the sword. And he goes, and Saul told me, finish me off. He's like, so I went, and I finished him off. And David goes, who are you? You ready? He goes, I'm an Amalekite. Turn the lights down. Turn the lights way down. The very king, do you understand that because Saul didn't kill Agag, Agag killed Saul? God said, destroy the Amalekites. And on Saul's last moment, the very people that were destroying him were the very thing he didn't want to kill. Hear me, friend. If you don't stop with your addiction, listen to me. This is love. This is grace. This is the most, if you know true grace, this is true grace. And I can give you my testimony how God pulled me out of the muck and mire. I didn't want to preach. I didn't want God and his grace. I can't even get up here and preach grace because it's beyond my own understanding that God would forgive Hitler and God would forgive any of these wicked people, but he does. Because his grace is that ridiculous. But his grace does not allow you to keep Agag in the corner. And I don't want any prayer team up here yet. I want everyone in this room to close your eyes. And can we get the music started? Just, you could just put it low. Listen, my message tonight was not going to be this. My message tonight was going to be, let's equip you to go out and heal the sick and raise the dead. And God said no, because Agag hasn't been killed yet. And I cannot fight for Abbotsford until Agag is dead. Because if I give them a revival and they don't kill Agag, when that revival's blazing and thousands are coming to the revival and Agag decides he wants to raise hell, I'm not letting it happen. Listen, I have fathers around me. Nino and other people, mainly Nino, has become a father to me since I've gotten saved. And he will always constantly, if he sees something that is not right, he will tell me, this is not right. You need to change this. You don't say this. You need to do this. Why? Because he's making sure that Agag doesn't ever come back and take me down. If there is an Agag in your life and you say, there is one thing that I've held back these last 3 days. I did not want to go this way, but this is the Holy Spirit in this place. There is one compromise. I do not care if you're a pastor. I don't care if you're a leader. I don't care if Pastor Mike, I'm giving you a free clearance right now to get it right. You will not get kicked off your ministry team, and I know the pastors would support me. You will not get, they will not bash you over the head. When the body gets hurt, we don't cut off our leg. When it gets broken, we heal it. You hear me, friend? If you haven't killed Agag, I want you right now. Don't hype. I am not about hype. I am not about emotions. I'm about the anointing. Come up right now, all over this room. If you have that one thing and you said, I have not got rid of it. You can be 90 years old. You can be 50. You still cuss. You still drink. I don't know what it is. I want you to come up here. Don't look at nobody and get on your knees and pack these altars out. Listen, if you said, Isaiah, there is something in my life. And listen, there's stuff I have to get right every day. Repentance is continual. In the Greek, it meant present, past, and future tense. I have issues. You want to know one of my issues? I judge people too easy. I look at people and I think in my head, I know where they're at. You know what I had to repent for today? God, help me with being judgmental towards people that I barely met. Because I'll meet somebody in the church and instantly I'm like, oh, this is their testimony. Oh, this is their intention. Oh, they're here for this. And God said, that is wrong. That is not of me. And I repented of it. Does Isaiah Saldivar still have things he needs to fix? Absolutely. But I'll tell you this, I killed Agag. And the Bible says Samuel went to Agag and chopped him in to pieces. And I don't know what your Agag is right now, but I want you to raise your voice and to begin to chop it in pieces right now. If your Agag is porn, chop him into pieces. If your Agag is gossiping, this might get a couple more people from the crowd up. If you're in this crowd and you gossip, period, about anybody, I want you to come up here because that will keep you from going to heaven. This is not hype. Come on, if you feel this in your spirit, I want you to say it like you mean it. Say, I'm killing it tonight. Agag will not come back and get me. I am cutting its head off. If you have generational curses up, I want you up here. If you have generational curses that have fought your family, lying, cheating, drugs, alcohol, come on. I want you to find a spot. I know the altars are all the way full to the back, but that's okay. Get in the hallway. Get in the corner. I don't care where you're at. We are going to cry out to God, and we're going to break generational curses, and we're going to kill Agag, whatever it is. And listen, if you're content being where you're at, stay where you're at. I did not come here to beg Christians to give it all to God. I would love you to extend your hand and we can get that music up. And I want all over this altar for 5 to 10 minutes. We're not praying for nobody. We're not doing anything. We are going to let the Holy Spirit do what he does best. And he's going to hover through this room forgiving people. He's going to hover through this room changing people. He's going to pour out a grace. He's going to pour out love. He's going to pour out holiness. He's going to pour out fire. He's going to pour out repentance. Repentance is a gift from God that nobody deserves. Come on, if you have that, raise your voice right now. And just to begin to cry out to the Holy Spirit and just begin to ask. The Bible says that the people cried out to God and God heard their cries and forgave their sins. Come on, kill Agag. God, I break right now Jezebel off this room in the name of Jesus. Come on, raise your voice. I break compromise in the name of Jesus. I kill Agag in the name of Jesus. I break alcohol, generational curses. I break drugs in the name of Jesus. I break compromise in the name of Jesus. I break that lie that says this is legalism. That's a lie from the pits of hell. Come on, God's not just going to move if we sit here quiet. Come on, ask God for holiness. This is not something you work for. This is a gift from God. Come on, holy, come on, sing that out. The holiness of God is all over this place. You will never be the same. Agag is dead and he's not coming back. I am not going back to porn. I am not going back to gossip. I am not going back to cursing. I am not. God wants to kill Agag. It's not your job to kill him. It's God's job, but you have to do your part. Come on, if you haven't been baptized in the Holy Spirit, ask the Holy Spirit to baptize you. When I got baptized the first time, the night I got saved, I began to speak in tongues. Nobody laid hands on me. Come on, no one laid hands on me. I sat there and I said, God, I'm going to give you everything. I'm giving you everything. And the Holy Ghost came out of heaven from the top of my head to the soles of my feet. And I stand here 3 years later, never been the same. Never been the same. Don't wait till someone lays hands on you. This is not about a man. This is not about a movement. I break shame. I break shame off of every young woman in this place. I break shame off of every young man in this place. I break guilt in the name of Jesus. I break guilt off of every young woman in the name of Jesus. Come on, purity. We've heard the grace, we heard the love, but we need holiness. We need repentance. We need purity. Come on, we need to be separated unto God. Separate yourself unto God. Become a flame upon our heart tonight. Come on, cry out. Don't be afraid. Forget about what the person next to you thinks. I promise you, they don't matter. Forget about what they think. If you're a leader in this room, just don't get on your knees. It doesn't matter. Forget about what anybody thinks. You don't have to be in sin for God to touch you tonight. Just forget it. I just want you right now just to let the Holy Spirit just encounter you. It doesn't matter. We're not letting Agag take out this movement. We're not letting the Amalekites take out this movement. God is not going to stop what he's doing in Windword. He's not going to stop what he's doing in TC. And he's not going to stop what he's doing in Awakening 604. The devil is the liar. Jesus is the Messiah. Come on, let's lift up a cry tonight. It's happening all over this place. All over this place, young people, old people, middle-aged people are getting their lives changed, not by a man, not by a ministry, but by the Holy God of Israel. This is the same God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He is in this place tonight. He is not outside this church knocking. He's here. The Holy Ghost has come here. I don't fake it. I don't fabricate it. The fire is here. Come on, it's Saturday night. Come on, let's cry out.
Let us be a generation
marked with holiness. Father, mark us with holiness, God. God, we want to be holy. God, we ask you, God, let us be holy. Let us be holy, God. God, we don't want to be the same. God, we want your presence. God, forgive us. God, we want you to dwell with us. Forgive America, God. Forgive Canada, Father, of our complacency. Forgive Canada of our mediocrity, God. Father, forgive us for taking the ark for granted. We will not touch the ark.
Purified, set apart, holy unto you, God.
Not done. Come on, we're not going to end until the Holy Spirit tells me he's done. God's not done moving in this altar. He's not done. Look at all the way to the back of the room. People are lined to the back wall. People are to the back wall on their knees. This is only a work of the Holy Spirit. This is not by clever theology. This is not by good word. This is not by good eschatology. This is by the Holy Spirit. People to the back of the building on their knees weeping. Father, we need you. Father, Isaiah Saldivar needs you tonight. God, I don't want to lose my anointing. I don't want to lose the anointing of the Holy Ghost. I don't want Bill Johnson's anointing. I don't want Corey Russell's anointing. I don't want Banning Leafshire's anointing. I don't want Rick Pino's anointing. I don't want Eddie James' anointing. I want the anointing of the Holy Spirit that you've given for me. Come on, don't try to be like the preachers you know. Don't ask to be an Isaiah Saldivar. Ask for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Right now, ask for the anointing. Right now, if you don't have the anointing, ask for the anointing. Reinhard Bonnke told me, Isaiah, do not ask for anyone's anointing. Don't ask for mine, and don't ask for anyone. Reinhard Bonnke said, ask for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Do not ask for anyone else's anointing but the Holy Spirit's. God's anointing people tonight. God is anointing and calling people tonight. Father, pour out your anointing upon your people.
Only to see your face.
Father, we've gathered, we've consecrated ourselves. This is true move of God. This is true revival. We're not fabricating the fire. Now pour out your anointing. Come on, if you want that, just put your hands out all over this place and just say, God, anoint me. Just say, listen, if you don't have it, just say, God, anoint me. Just like Samuel poured the anointing over David, some of you will feel a hot fire from that. When I got anointed, I felt heat from the top of my head to the soles of my feet. That was the anointing and the fire going down me. Just like they poured the anointing, they drenched David in the anointing. God is going to drench you in his anointing. Every one of us. I'm a leader. I travel America. I need it tonight. I'm going to ask God tonight, anoint me. Every one of us need an anointing. Every one of us need a fresh anointing right now. Only one word. Come on. God will find people that he sees that are willing to go, that are willing to go out into the world and make disciples, and he will anoint them. I see people all over this altar right now. Come on, I see Brandon right now in the Spirit. God's anointing you, Brandon, in the name of Jesus. God is anointing you right now at this altar. I see the anointing.
Lord God Almighty.
Come on, close your eyes. Do not look around. Please don't look at the stage. I'm nothing right now. This has nothing to do with me. This is sovereign of the Holy Spirit moving. I didn't plan this. I didn't put this in notes. I want you to focus your eyes on the one that is holy, not me. I am flawed. I am human. I want you to look at the one who has fire, as Nino told us. He has fire in his eyes. And I want you to gaze into the fire of his eyes and ask him for that anointing. Don't even have your eyes open. There's no reason to open your eyes.